Words of Joy and Hope. It is the first Sunday of Lent, year C, and the readings are from Luke chapter 4, 1 to 13. And the commentaries by Father Fernando Armelini. A good Sunday to all. We begin Lent, and like every year, Lent begins by introducing us Jesus being tempted. The evangelist Mark, who is the first of the evangelists, simply says that Jesus was taken to the desert by the Spirit, and there he was tempted during 40 days by Satan, and he was with beast and with the angels served him. The number 40 does not have to be taken literally. It indicates a complete generation in biblical language, and Mark wants to tell us that temptations have accompanied Jesus throughout his life. The letter to the Hebrews says that he was tempted in everything like us, except sin. In the years that followed, the Christian communities continued to reflect about this reality of Jesus being tempted, a very consoling truth for us because it makes us feel Jesus very close to us, one that, as the letter to the Hebrews says, can understand our fragility and our weaknesses because he has been tested on everything like us, and he knows how hard and difficult it is to let ourselves be always guided by the Spirit, by the divine life. Jesus possessed the Spirit in fullness, and it has always followed the impulse of the Spirit, not the impulse of the instinct of the flesh, as Paul calls it. The Christian communities have synthesized this experience of the temptations of Jesus that lasted all his life in three scenes, which are three parables. To understand these three parables, we must first of all put them in context. They are placed right after the baptism of Jesus. During baptism, a voice from heaven presented Jesus as the beloved Son of the Father, in whom he is pleased. And in the Semitic culture, when one is recognized as son, it means more than generated by him, one that resembled his father. One was recognized as a son not only by the semblance, but by the values that he cultivated, by what he believed, by the way he lived, and thus reproduced the human present in the Father. So in baptism, the Father of Heaven sees his Son, and who begins his public life in the midst of sinners. He recognizes him as the one who perfectly reflects his face. It is the invitation to look at Jesus and the way that, moved by the Spirit, he relates to things, to people, and to God. These are the three temptations that accompanied Jesus throughout his life, and that are the same temptations that we experience. In the first and the third scenes, the devil questions Jesus about this divine filiation. In fact, the first and third of these temptations begins like this: "If you are the Son of God, do what I tell you." At the center of temptations is the theme of divine filiation. The devil's voice wants to suggest to Jesus how to be a child of God. We have said many times, but I will repeat it. The devil is not the imp that we traditionally imagine. It is the compulsion that leads us in the opposite direction to the voice of the Spirit, and we all experience this devil. It is the opposite to our identity, true identity as children of God. The devil's voice comes from our biological nature and gives us suggestions contrary to the spirit. We all do this experience in many moments, in each option that we must do. We always hear two voices, that of the flesh, as Paul calls it, and that of the spirit, the voice of the Son of God. Faced with one that has done something bad to us, the voice of instinct leads us to pay back with the same coin. But there is another voice inside us, the voice of the Son of God, who is present in all of us, which tells us to do exactly the opposite. You must love. The devil gives his suggestions, and we will see later what is it that the devil suggests to Jesus. And it goes something like this. If you are the Son of God, and this I have no doubt, I am going to tell you how you can resemble your Father. I'll tell you how you can be God. We will notice that these are the same suggestions that the devil presents to each one of us. Let us listen to the first of these suggestions. Jesus, filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the desert for 40 days to be tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and when they were over, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live on bread alone." The devil gives his first suggestion. If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. What does this image mean? What does the devil suggest about the way of relating with the goods of this world, with the material reality? The reasoning that the devil did to Jesus is the following. Now, the devil says, okay, you are the Son of God, therefore you must reveal the face of your Father. And if you show people a beautiful face of God, if you show them that you are capable of intervening in our world and to solve the problem of hunger and all the other needs of people with miraculous interventions, Jesus, pay attention. What people expect from God is this and nothing else. If God meets a request that are related to material needs, if you reveal this face of God, everyone will follow you. Because this is the God that people want. A God who does what people ask for does not make them angry. It is good if people ask God for a favor and he grants it to them. Jesus, think, you know that the Father in heaven wants his sons and daughters to be well, to be happy. God does not want anything else. He wants the joy for all his sons and daughters. He has created a beautiful world precisely for this reason. And realize how important bread is. You know that in the Bible, the verb to eat appears 910 times. And this shows how important it is for God that everyone has enough food. Therefore, exercise all your capacities to produce the material bread, the goods of this world. Do not think about anything else, because this is what people need. So, how is this temptation presented to us today? By now you may wonder, how do I know what the devil has suggested to Jesus? Well, because it is exactly the same thing that happens to us. To think of the material life, which is the only safe way to live. You see it, you touch it, you experience it. The other life, you know, leave it aside. It is a strong voice that appears masked also to believers who, perhaps without realizing it, can give the biological life an absolute value, as if the biological life were the only life and of which you have to be interested and worry about and nothing else. So certain expressions that we hear in some Christians reveal this conception. The important thing is health. Let's try to live well here. Then we will see what happens on the other side. Religion serves if it is to make our life better here, to get some advantages and live better here. Therefore, here, religion is at the service of biological life, as if it were the only one. It is not that it is not important, but it is not the only one. The consequence is attachment to the goods of this world, accumulating to try to make eternal this our life. As I need things to live, the temptation is that I live for these things. I need to work, but I do not live to work. Creatures are good as long as they do not become an absolute to become our God. So what is the answer that Jesus gives? He does not deny that one must pawn for the bread that we need to nourish our life that perishes, the biological life. But people do not live only by material bread. We need a food that nourishes the life of the children of God that we are, the life of the eternal. We do not have only a biological father who has given us a life that ends. We have a father who has given us his very life and who is nourished by the wisdom that comes from God, the wisdom that comes from heaven. And Lent is a providential time to reflect on how to relate to the goods of this world. And so we ask ourselves, are certain expenses, certain pleasure trips compatible with evangelical options, certain bank accounts, certain investments, certain fabulous sums left in inheritance to the children? It is difficult to be content with the daily bread so that everyone has what it takes to live. After having proposed a good relationship with the goods of this world, let us listen now what the devil suggests. Then he took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a single instant. The devil said to him, "I shall give to you all this power and glory, for it has been handed over to me, and I may give it to whomever I wish. All this will be yours if you worship me." Jesus said to him in reply, "It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him alone shall you serve." The second suggestion that the devil gives refers to how to relate to people. Like all of us, Jesus has also experienced the desire to be an important person, one who comes to do something extraordinary in life. So, how to satisfy this compulsion that we all feel? And the devil gives his suggestion. It takes Jesus to the top of a mountain and shows him all the powers he can master. It is not difficult to imagine the reasoning that the devil makes to Jesus. And it is not difficult because each one of us feels these suggestions in the intimacy of ourselves. So let us imagine the devil saying to Jesus, "Jesus, you are a person with extraordinary qualities. Become aware of this ability because you can become a star. You can assert your superiority. All will bow to your feet. You will leave a sign of your passage through this world, and history books will talk about you. They will, of course, mention you with the title of Great. And you will give the name to cities like Alexander, Alexandria, Caesar, Caesarea, Antiochus, Antioquia, and you will conquer an imperishable glory. You can be big, powerful, dominating, because you have that ability. You will live in luxury. But to get to this, you must worship me. What does it mean, worship this voice, this desire, this compulsion? It means you must believe in what I tell you. You must obey my commands. And concretely, to obtain this power, this success, you must accept my logic. Think about your own interest. Do not pay attention to the poor, to the needy, the orphans. They make you lose time. Exploit them if necessary. Then, to succeed according to my logic, you must cheat, know how to seduce people, talk to people's stomachs. You should not be very scrupulous, because in the world, those who have succeeded and went ahead are the thieves. But if you do not agree to what I am suggesting, you will not have any success. This is the covenant that the devil proposed to Jesus. And it is the same pact, more or less, what he proposes to each one of us. To employ our talents, to succeed, to dominate, to oppress others, to be served. Let us think that this pact with the devil implies if one follows this logic. Think of certain riches accumulated in a few years. Where do they come from, if it is not from this logic of the devil? Pact with the devil, they used to call it in former times. But there is a second voice that suggests how to respond to that compulsion that leads us to do something great in life. It is a compulsion that comes from the spirit of the life of the eternal that has been given to us. It is the spirit who extinguishes this voice of the devil that will ruin our lives, that will make us pursue the ephemeral grandeur of this world that in the end will reveal itself in all its limitation. And Jesus answers, "You shall worship the Lord your God, you shall worship him alone." It is not this logic that should be adored and followed, but the voice of God. He has to be worshipped. To worship God means to bow one's head to his word, to his proposal of a successful person. God has a proposal that is the opposite of the devil's suggestions. What does God propose? To domination, God proposes service. To searching for the first places, the option for the last position. To places of honor, look for the lowest places. Take the last position where you expect to receive orders from everyone. Be available for those who have need. Place your abilities at the service of others. To violence, the option for peace. To theft, loyalty. The option is between to dominate or to serve, between competing or being supportive, between stepping on others' feet or being a servant of the brothers and sisters. Jesus has made the opposite option to the one suggested by the devil. He became a servant. Let us listen to the third suggestion of the devil. Then he led him to Jerusalem, made him stand on the parapet of the temple, and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and with their hands, they will support you, lest you dash your feet against a stone. Jesus said to him in reply, It also says, You shall not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished every temptation, he departed from him for a time. Now, the third suggestion refers to the relationship with God, because you can also have a wrong relationship with God. And the temptation of the devil refers to a promise of God, which is found in Psalm 91. God promised to send his angels to care for his elect, and that they will carry them in their hands so their feet will not stumble on the stone. We understand this temptation very well. It is about asking God for a proof of his love. If you really love me, do what I tell you. Otherwise, I'm going to doubt of your love. This is the temptation that we experience and that we see that is present in the life of many Christians when they are convinced that God must protect them from more than the others. So he must miraculously protect them from evil when they invoke him. It's true, certainly, God has promised to send his angels to guard his sons and daughters. But what we need to know is who these angels are. The temptation here is that of a miraculism, to ask for miracles, to pretend that God intervenes with prodigies to help those who invoke him. And in fact, many times we hear that people in a situation of need invoke God. They ask for grace and even a prodigy, a miracle. And if this does not happen, and then they say, what is the use of believing? If in fact God exists, why does he not intervene when he should do it? The problem is that God respects creation. He has given people the ability to solve problems. These have great, huge capabilities, the people. God made available to them a creation that used according to his plan. It would be an earthly paradise. It would become a terrestrial paradise. But instead, people have established a wrong relationship with God, pretending that God should be the one to solve their problems. God respects creation and the laws of creation that he has willed. Therefore, we are on notice that certain religious practices try to bind the hands of God and make him do what we want. Certain devotions, like, for example, some with relics and other similar ones that are very close to the use of amulets or talismans. This is a temptation. It is not a devotion, a manifestation of a right relationship with God. No. God gives us the light to indicate how we should manage this world. Notice how the devil can even quote the Bible, but misinterpreting it. In this case, interpreted to the letter when the meaning is very diverse. The angels in the Bible have nothing to do with Hermes or Mercury, with the wings on their back and a halo on their head. Nothing to do with this type of angels. Angels in the Bible are the mediators of the Word of God, of his love, of his tenderness. These are the angels that God puts at our side. Those who help us not to get bogged down in the way of life. Those who speak to us and they reveal to us the word of God. We do not listen to the word of God through revelations, no. We hear it through the prophet. The prophet is a person who has a sensitivity of heart and gets in tune with the thought of God and then communicates this thought of God to people. Let us try to recognize these angels and also put our lives at the service of God's love design. And so, we too will be angels of the brothers and sisters we have by our side. And Jesus answers, "You shall not test the Lord your God. Never doubt that he is by your side, that he accompanies you and has a project of love for your life. God is faithful to his love. He will never betray you, even if you turn away from him. He will continue to love you. If we believe in him, you do not need these tests. Continue to trust in him, although appearances suggest otherwise. Jesus has given us proof that he has always resisted this temptation. He has never doubted the love of the Father, never asked for proof of his love. He has never doubted his fidelity, not even on the cross, when faced with the absurdity of what was happening to him, he could have come to think that even God has forgotten him. He remained always united and faithful to the Father. In every moment of life, happy, painful moments, we must of course pray to our Father in heaven, but not so that he grants us privileges or modifies his plans and adapts them to ours, but to give us the light and the strength to come out more mature of these tests." The conclusion of today's gospel text says, "Once the temptation was over, the devil left him until another time." That other occasion is found in the Gospel of Luke, where the devil is no longer spoken of in the Gospel of Luke except until the moment when the Passion arrives. That was the great moment of Jesus' trial, when he was put to the test of doubting that the Father was by his side, that he still loved him. And Jesus has resisted this temptation. "In your hands, Father, I commend my spirit." This concludes the life of Jesus, and in the same way, we must have our relationship and live our relationship with God, not like those who ask for privilege for this life. No. We trust God and his light that allows us to make sense of our life. I wish everyone a good start of Lent, a good Sunday, and a good week.